Good evening. When I was asked to come here tonight, I was very moved, and I felt very honored. And then I thought, I'm never going to be able to get to Washington. I'm so busy sleuthing, I'll never get enough time off from work. And then I said to myself, damn it all, I'm going to move heaven and earth to get there. Because Bette Davis was so important to me as a young actress. At the age of 17, starting out in Gaslight, she was my inspiration. Her performance as Mildred in A Human Bondage was my reference point. I never dreamed, honestly, that 25 years later, filming Death on the Nile in Egypt, that I would be sharing a dressing room with Bette Davis. But what a dressing room it was. It was a tiny, remember this, Bette? It was a tiny two-bunk cabin on an old, rusty, creaky river steamer. And four of us, Bette and I, Maggie Smith, and Mia Farrow, and the wardrobe lady, were all jammed into this tiny little cabin. Two of the actresses had to lie on the bunks while one stood up against the wall, and then the other was dressed by the wardrobe lady. Well, Bette, at this point, was lying on the bunk. I noticed out of the corner of my eye this slight look of impatience, and I thought, oh, my goodness, you know. Ooh, is she gonna raise hell? This is gonna be Death on the Nile. Not a bit of it, not a bit of it. Her consummate professionalism came to the fore, and her wry sense of humor, and she poured her patience and her indomitability and her towering talent into the role, as she always has done. Bette has always said, I am a character actress. Can we ever forget the ashen face of Mrs. Skeffington? All those pathetic eyebrows in the early stages of Now Voyager? Or how many of us would be willing to shave our heads to play Queen Elizabeth? Of course, I'd be willing to cut my legs off to the knee to play opposite Errol Flynn, but that's another story. The movies that she made were so memorable, so startlingly individual, so Bette Davis. And just when we think maybe her brilliant career is slowing down, not a bit, she comes along with the wails of August and sets us all on our heel again. In her home, Bette has a pillow. And with it, the embroidery says, old age is not for sissies. For Bette Davis, youth, middle age, no time of life is a place for sissies. She is an original. There has never been anyone before or since who could touch her.
Fasten your seatbelts. It's going to be a bumpy night.
In the New England of her childhood, the fortune teller told her, one day your name will be world famous. She smiled and said, I know. Her first play, she was spellbound. Everything fell into place, she said. I knew what I was, an actress. Not everyone agreed. Her summer stock director slapped her for using her hands too much. But she persisted and clung single-mindedly to her craft and her ambition. 21, she had her first Broadway lead, a rave review from Brooks Atkinson, and then a contract from Universal Studios. When she arrived in Hollywood, she said, "I was a mousy 22-year-old with knobby knees and a pelvic slouch." Hollywood was a factory town that knew what it wanted. Carbon copies. They tried to turn her into one, too. But she fought 2 years for a role other actresses feared.
You cad! You dirty swine! I never cared for you, not once. I was always making a fool of you. You bored me stiff. I hated you. It made me sick when I had to let you kiss me. I only did it because you begged me. You hounded me. You drove me crazy. And after you kissed me, I always used to wipe my mouth. Wipe my mouth!
As Mildred in Of Human Bondage, she unleashed a raw power. She said, "I did something no actress would think of. I dared not to be loved."
You know what you are, you gizzy leg monster! You're a cripple, a cripple, a cripple!
Despite her newly won stardom, she was bound by contract to take every role they gave her. Her fight for literate scripts was ignored. She was powerless to choose her own future. When she was offered the role of a female lumberjack, she told Jack Warner, "No more," and walked out without pay. First woman to challenge the system had gambled and won.
Charlie, you're out of your mind. You know you can't wear red to the Olympus ball.
Can't I? I'm going to.
This is 1852, Dumplin. 1852, not the dark ages.
Girls don't have to simper around in white just because they're not married.
My father drank himself to death. My mother lives in Paris. I take a great deal of exercise. I'm accustomed to a reasonable quantity of tobacco and alcohol. I'm said to have a sense of humor.
Didn't think about it much. If I had, I'd have known you died before I did. But I couldn't have guessed you'd get heart trouble so early, so bad. I'm lucky, Horace. I've always been lucky. I'll be lucky again.
The other bottle. Please, upstairs, in my room, in the drawer.
galvanic force, she willed a universe of characters into being. She is an artist who never gave less than everything.
As we celebrate the 10th anniversary of these Kennedy Center honors, we're proud to present three distinguished past honorees, Mr. Jimmy Stewart, Miss Jessica Tandy, and Mr. Hume Cronyn.
When Bette Davis and I came out to Hollywood, that was quite a while ago, wasn't it? Well, we had to sign 7-year contracts with options. And it was the studio that had all the options. If you refused to do a picture, you were suspended, with the suspension time added to the 7 years. Your studio also controlled the loan out cars. They decided whether or not you could make a picture for another studio. The rest of us just assumed that, well, this was the way the world was, and not Bette. Not at all Bette Davis. In the tradition of our ancestors, who were at the Boston Tea Party, she wrote Jack Warner the following letter.
June 21st, 1936. Dear Mr. Warner, I know you have the right to keep me from working. A great unhappiness to me because I enjoy working, especially after my long vacation. I am so rested, it hurts. As to the loan out clause, every once in a while a part comes along peculiarly suited to me. I want to feel at liberty to take advantage of it. You see, a change does me good, makes me do better work. I am also ambitious to be known as a great actress. And I might. Who can tell? I would be willing to take less money if, in consideration, you give me my rights. But if I continue to appear in more mediocre pictures, I will have no career left worth fighting for. Betty.
Some months later, Mr. Warner got another letter, this time from one of his own executives.
April the 12th, 1937. Dear Jack, I wish you could hear the comments of the women at the Strand about Bette Davis. You hear them say, there's a gal who doesn't eat a lot of junk all over her face and who doesn't have to put on the glamour to hold us in our seats. In other words, where the average glamour girl fears to tread, Bette Davis steps in. We should let her stay that way and under no condition try to make a Kay Francis out of her. Bette Davis is a female Cagney. And if we give her the right parts, we're going to have a star that will pay the interest on our bonds for years to come.
Bette Davis used to say, actresses are different from the girl next door. We're driven, obsessed, absolutely convinced of the rightness of pretending, the rightness of the character we portray. And one of our colleagues, Laurence Olivier, defined acting this way. It is the art of persuasion. The actor persuades himself first, and through himself, the audience. The actor is the illuminator of the human heart. He must not be too proud to scavenge the tiniest bit of human circumstance, to observe it, to find it, to use it.
Sam Goldwyn put it in another way. He said, the most important thing in acting is honesty. And once you learn to fake that, you're in. We all know that acting isn't steady work and everything. And actors wonder what to do about it. Well, in 1961, the following full-page ad appeared in Variety.
Situation wanted. Mother of three, 10, 11, and 15. Divorcee. 30 years of experience as an actress in motion pictures. Mobile still, and more affable than rumor would have it. Wants steady employment in Hollywood. Has had Broadway. References upon request. Signed, Bette Davis.
Survival, imagination, spirit, fire, and ice. These are the gifts of a great actress, the gifts of Bette Davis. The title of one of her greatest movies is taken from a poem by Walt Whitman. Now, voyager, sail thou forth to seek and find. Bette, your life has been a brilliant voyage on stormy seas and calm. In the flickering images of film, you dared to seek and helped us to find an illumination of the human heart.
Bette, God bless you. One of the